children, let's continue with the chapter number 11, parts to modernization. So first we are talking about Japan country. In this chapter we are basically focusing on Japan and China, and in our last module we have discussed about the Meiji Restoration and what were the changes that took place because of the Meiji Restoration in Japan. Now we are going to continue the same changes that happened in Japan after the Meiji Restoration in 1870s. Okay, so now we are going to talk about a very important topic and a very important debate, that is westernization and tradition. So as we know that Japan was westernizing, Japan khud ko westernize kar raha tha, modernize kar raha tha, aur unke jitne bhi sare ideas the they were basically borrowed from the European countries. Now there was a debate among two sections. One was that who wanted to completely westernize the Japan country. On the other hand were those who wanted Japanese tradition to be the basis of the development. So now we are going to see who were the people who were in favor of westernization, what was their view, what was their point of view, and then later on we are going to study about the people who are supporting the tradition. So there were various types of Japanese intellectual. One of them was Fuzuka Yukuchi. According to him, he was actually a leading Meiji intellectual, and he expressed that Japan should reach the highest point of civilization like US and Western European countries have already reached. And he said that Japan must expel Asia, which he meant that Japan must shed its Asian characteristics and become part of the West, which means he was in favor of complete westernization and shedding its identity, especially of being an Asian country. Then later on, we see the next generation, which is the next generation of the intellectuals. They questioned this total acceptance of Western ideas and urged that national pride should be built on the indigenous values. Indigenous means the traditional values. So the philosopher who was in favor of this view was Miyake Setsurai, and he argued that each nation must develop its special talents in the interest of world civilization. He said ki agar if somebody wants, or if some nation wants to, you know, if some nation wants to contribute to the world, then they should develop their own identity and their own culture so that they can add something to the world and not simply just copy the Western world or the European or the USA world, who are already a developed nation. And later on we see some different intellectuals who are in favor of the middle path. They were attracted by Western liberalism, but they do not want Japan to be military leader, but they wanted Japan to be a democratic country. And one such leader was Eyuki Emori. So we have read about three leaders, and the third leader was Eyuki Emori, who said that constitutional government, he admired the constitutional government and said that we should take our inspiration from French Revolution, where there was a doctrine of natural rights of men and popular sovereignty, and therefore he spoke of a liberal education that would develop each individual. He said freedom is more precious than the order, therefore he advocated voting right for women as well. So therefore we can see that how different types of intellectual, they wanted to bring changes, and how different ideologies at that time were prevailing in Japan. Okay, now next is, what was the influence of such modernization on the daily life of the Japanese people? So like all the other spheres, the sphere of the daily life of people also transformed, and it transformed into a modern society. So earlier as there was patriarchal household, many generations used to live under a single roof. But with the coming up of modernization and new family ideas, the norm of nuclear family came into being, where husband and wife lived as breadwinner, which means husband was the sole earner and wife was the homemaker. and there were new concept of domesticity that were emerging, and there were greater demands for entertainment and for the technology as well. As you can see here, the coming up of electrical rice cooker and various other equipments that were being demanded. And in 1920s, we see that cheap housing facilities were also available in Japan, and just you can get a house by 200 yen, and those who are earning, they can pay that in installments. So the daily life of Japan also transformed with the coming up of the modern ideas in Japan. Now next, we see that overcoming modernity. It is a very interesting debate. Overcoming modernity, as the name suggests, कि किस तरह से modernity को overcome किया जाए, modernity को खुद पर हावी ना होते हुए अपने culture के साथ किस तरह से उसे मिलाया जाए, so that one should not lose their own traditions. So this was about that. So basically in this we are going to study about how Japan various intellectuals and various people of different fields, how what were their arguments in favor of overcoming modernity. So state center nationalism found full expression in 1930s and 1940s as Japan launched war to extend its empire in China and other parts of Asia, a war that emerged into Second World War after Japan attacked USA at Pearl Harbor. So in this particular period saw greater controls on society, the repression and imprisonment of dissidents, which means those people who were opposing is time pe specifically jab Japan World War II mein bahut involved tha, there was a greater control that was imposed on the people. So because of all these conditions, a symposium, which means a meeting, a conference was organized whose title was Overcoming Modernity in 1943. In this symposium, a debate took place, and there was a dilemma that the people of Japan were facing, that how to combat the West while being modern. So kis tarah se jo West hai, jo West puri tarah se khud ko West ki tarah aur baki country ki tarah khud ko na badle, lekin hum modern bhi rahe. So there were various people who have put on their views on such topic, and one such was a musician, Morai Suboru, who said that it is very important that the music should be rewritten, and Japanese music should be written more and more rather than just listening to the same song, just having the same song played on different Western instruments. Apart from it, we see philosopher Nishiten Ketiji, who defined modern as the unity of three streams of Western thought, that is the Renaissance, which means the period of the 14th-15th century when the man was considered to be the most important agent of change, the Protestant Reformation, in which we see major changes happening in the religion, especially Christianity, and in the rise of natural sciences, which was the scientific revolution of the period 17th century and 18th century, when we see the coming up of great scientists like Isaac Newton. So therefore, he argued that Japan's moral energy had helped it to escape colonization, and it is their duty to establish a new order on in the greater Asia only. That means they should keep their identity of Asian and should set an example for all the Asian countries to how to be modern, but instilling their traditional values. And this vision was very important to integrate science and religion as well in their whole countries, traditions and ideas. Now, what happened after Japan was defeated by US in Second World War? How did it emerge as a global economic power? So first of all, after the World War, as we see that two nuclear bombs were dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki, so there was a great suffering that was seen in Japan. But US ने अपना एक ऑक्यूपेशन भेजा, अपनी एम्बेसडरी भेजी, और जापान को पूरी तरह से डीमिलिट्राइज किया, और उनका एक न्यू कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन बनाया. उसमें उन्होंने आर्टिकल 9 इंक्लूड किया, विच हैड द सो कॉल्ड नो वॉर क्लॉज दैट रिनाउंस द यूज ऑफ वॉर एज एन इंस्ट्रूमेंट ऑफ द स्टेट पॉलिसी ऑफ जापान. Then agrarian reforms were, there were various agrarian reforms that happened and trade unions were re-established. But Zaibastu, which was the organization dominated by some families in the trade, it was now dismantled. And new political parties were revived after the World War, and there were new elections that took place. And in 1946, women voted for the first time in Japan. Now, after rebuilding, the Japan economy, after shattering its defeat, was a post-war miracle. So it is considered to be a miracle that how Japan went on to a fast pace of development, even though it has faced such a huge defeat by the hands of US. So basically, it is said that the social cohesion of the pre-war year was strengthened, allowing for a close working of the government, bureaucracy and industry, because there was a feeling of collectivism in the Japanese people, which they have already done from their ancient time as well. Wo log hamesha saath mein rahe hain. Jab hum specially Meiji restoration ke time pe bhi dekhte hain ki Japan mein development bahut fast pace par, because people believe in each other, they believe in their country, therefore it was easy for them to, you know, to increase the pace of their development, because their sentiments towards their country were very strong. Therefore, we can see that US support, they have gained US support as well, because Korea and Vietnam wars were happening, and therefore US needed the full build equipments and everything which Japan used to provide. So therefore they were able to build their economy very fastly, even though they have a huge defeat in World War II. Now, very important things that happened in after the World War II, the year are very important. Yes, so 1964 mein Olympics Tokyo mein hue first hum dekhte hain, it was a symbol of the coming age, that it was a symbol of its modernization. Then we see the coming up of the high speed bullet train in 1964 only, and later on we see that the advancement of technology of Japan, because of which they were able to produce cheaper goods. Then in 1960 we saw the growth of civil society movement as well, because industrialization bahut zyada ho raha tha aur environmental logo ki health pe us cheez ka bahut zyada effect ho raha tha, especially cardium jo poisoning thi wo bahut hi, it was leading to various painful diseases, and therefore we see that in 1960s there was mercury poisoning in Minamata, and on grassroots level the pressure was increasing so as to make various changes in Japan, especially in the working condition. So government took legal actions and helped to improve the condition. From mid 1980s there has been a decreasing decline in interest in the environmental issues, as Japan enacted some of the strictest environmental controls, because Japan har baar ki tarah is baar bhi unhone apni problem ko साइडलाइन करने के बजाय उस पर ध्यान दिया, उस पर वर्क ऑन किया, एंड देयरफॉर दे वर एबल टू कंट्रोल द एनवायरनमेंट पॉल्यूशन दैट वाज हैपनिंग देयर. देयरफॉर मिड 1980s तक जब हम देखते हैं हर जगह इन अदर पार्ट्स ऑफ द वर्ल्ड दे आर वेरियस एनवायरमेंटल मूवमेंट्स आर हैपनिंग, जापान इज स्टेबल एट दैट टाइम बिकॉज दे हैव एनेक्टेड वेरी स्ट्रिक्ट रेगुलेशंस रिगार्डिंग द एनवायरमेंट कंजर्वेशन. So therefore, today as a developed country, it faces the challenge of using its political and technological capabilities to maintain its position as a leading world power. So we can see that how Japan, that was a very small island country, how it slowly developed, and with the coming up of Meiji Restoration came the westernization, modernization, and finally Japan became a developed country. Now in our next module, we are going to start the country China.